need as a concept tonight is that we really want to bring together people from the Black Lives Matter, people of this generation of struggle, with the people, shall I say, of my generation and of the generation of many of us in the audience today. Because it is quite apparent, and indeed even slightly alarming to some degree, that many members of the younger generation are, shall we say, not as well acquainted with the issues of the past as they desperately need to be. So we're absolutely delighted to have you here this evening. I don't want to go on and on. Let me just say a few words of introduction, Dr. Cole and Stanley Nelson. Johnnetta, of course, is very well known to everybody. She's a leading person in education, as well as the director of the National Museum of African Art at the Smithsonian Institution. She has had a very distinguished career in academia and in public life. She's been president of Spelman, the first female black president of Spelman College, and president of Bennett College. She's been taught at Emory. She's taught here at Hunter. She's had she had a very important role, which I wasn't even aware of, at the University of Massachusetts Amherst in developing their Black Studies program. I don't know where to begin in all this detail, except to say that in addition to all these many achievements, she has been the recipient of many honors. She was part of President Clinton's transition team for education in 1992. In 2010, she received the African American Woman's Excellence Award for her work. In 2013, she received the highest citation of the International Civil Rights Center and Museum, the Alston Jones International Civil and Human Rights Award. She has received honorary degrees from Williams College, from Bates College, from Oberlin, her alma mater, Mount Holyoke, Mills College, Howard, North Carolina A&T, and many other places. In 2015, she got the BET Honors in Education Award. So we are absolutely delighted that Johnnetta has been able to spare time from our very busy schedule to help us to lead these discussions, of which this is the first. Secondly, I would like to introduce Stanley Nelson. Many of you already know of him. He's a native New Yorker, a son of CUNY, a very most important part of it, because Stanley Nelson's career speaks to the mission of CUNY and a public university. That is somebody who has found a way of uniting his professional interests with his social and political and cultural concerns in such a way that the things that CUNY stands for and public education stands for are executed at the highest level of professional skill. So we're delighted to have him here with us. His career, he got his BFA in degree in 76 from City College, the Leonard Davis Film School. And then after graduation, he worked with William Greaves. His first debut film was $2 and a Dream, the story of Madame C.J. Walker. Then he worked with PBS and has done outstanding documentaries on the Black press, Soldiers Without Swords, and the award-winning 2000 Black International Cinema Festival, dear to my heart, of course, Marcus Garvey, Look for Me in the Whirlwind, in 2000. He has received fellowships from the American Film Institute, New York Foundation for the Arts, and received a MacArthur in 2002. Just to give an indication of his filmography, Freedom Bags in 1990, School for a New Society in 93, Puerto Rico, A Right to Choose, The Black Press, as I mentioned before, Marcus Garvey, as I mentioned before, running the campaign for city council, After the Battle for Affirmative Action, Immigration, Wounded Knee, Freedom Riders, Freedom Summer, and of course, the Black Panthers, Vanguard of the Revolution. Welcome very much, Stanley. You can hear from the account of what he has done. What I meant when I said this is a person who has combined his professional interests with the deepest political and social values. So we are fortunate indeed. How we will proceed this evening is that first we'll have the film clip which will be shown as soon as I get off the stage and free you from this, and then we will invite Johnnetta and Stanley to the platform. We'll have discussions. Then, of course, members of the audience will be absolutely free to raise any question that you would like to raise. So thank you again, and welcome to your university. Thank you.
Relations between police and Negroes throughout the country are getting worse. One of the cities most troubled by animosity between police and Negroes is Oakland, California.
People always talked about freedom and what that means. During that time period, being black in America meant that you didn't walk down the street with the same sense of safety and the same sense of privilege as a white person.
There was absolutely no difference in the way the police treated us in Mississippi than they did in California. They may not have called you nigger every day, but they treated you the same way they did in Mississippi.
Police jump on you, beat you up, put the gun at your head. This is what we were going through on a daily basis.
When I first met Hugh and Bobbitt, they were in the process of forming an organization for primarily self-defense. We didn't plan to have a nationwide organization, anything like that. We were organizing, dealing with the problems in Oakland.
We used the Black Panther as our symbol because of the nature of a panther. A panther doesn't strike anyone, but when he's assailed upon, that he'll back up first. But if the aggressor continues, then he'll strike out.
Huey had studied the law in Oakland at that particular time. Anyone could carry a firearm who did not have a felony conviction at the time. The firearm could not be concealed. It had to be in the open.
The California Penal Code, Section 12020 through 12027, and also the Second Amendment of the Constitution guarantees the citizen a right to bear arms on public property.
Huey said, we're going to carry our guns and we're going to follow the police. And if they stop someone, we're going to stop. We're going to maintain a legal distance. And we're going to observe these so-called law officers in the performance of their duties.
We were in the car and driving around having fun. We would be looking and at the pretty women, chasing the sisters. Then something might happen, and then all of a sudden, the focus would just become serious.
We're coming around the corner. Stay facing where you are.
We would stop. We would get out of the cars. We would walk up to the scene. Those who had rifles would carry them in the open, clearly visible.
We would stand at a distance where the police couldn't say they were interfering with their arrest or their detention of the individual, and make sure that there was no brutality.
We stood back with our weapons ready to throw down if necessary.
They would take the weapon and pass it across like this, and it would sweep right over the officer.
No one would do anything until a policeman ejected a round in the chamber. Then we would all eject rounds in the chamber. And all up and down the street, you could hear this clack, 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 clack.
And then when the traffic stopper, the incident's over, They bring the weapon down across by you like this and get back in their car and drive off. It was pretty intimidating.
We refer to ourselves as the Vanguard, and we were setting by example a new course that we wanted the entire community to follow.
No one wants to touch the legitimate hunter, but we've got to protect society from nuts with guns.
When bands of armed people with loaded weapons can move about our streets intimidating and frightening citizens, then I think we should act, and we intend to act. It's my intention to make it a misdemeanor to have loaded rifles and shotguns and weapons in public places.
The police department had went to a local congressman to get a bill written. So Huey called me up and says, we have to go to Sacramento. It was conceived as a media event that the press is always at the California State Capitol.
No one really wanted Huey himself to go because Huey was kind of a quick-tempered firebrand. Bobby was a little more cautious. And it was like, look, you know, you've been great so far, but, you know, you might blow it up there and, you know, bad things could happen. We caravaned to Sacramento. I think there were about 30 of us all together. And most of us had some weapon.
We was on the state capitol on the lawn, and Ronald Reagan, then the governor of the state of California, was there, about 10 feet away from us, holding a press conference with these young, like, parochial school kids. And what happened, as soon as the press seen us, they gravitated from Ronald Reagan over to where the Panthers was.
The Black Panther Party for Self-Defense calls upon the American people in general, and the black people in particular, to take careful note of the racist California legislature, which is now considering legislation aimed at keeping the black people disarmed and powerless. At the very same time, racist police agencies throughout the country are intensifying the terror, brutality, murder, and repression of black people.
The state assembly was in the midst of a heated debate when the young Negroes, armed with loaded rifles, shotguns, and pistols, marched into the Capitol.
When we got in the halls, you have to imagine there's 100 cameras, still cameras, print media people backing up, and I'm saying, where is the spectator section? And the press saying, this way, Bobby. Some party members got ahead of me with shotguns, pistol, and wound up on the actual floor of the California State Legislature.
They're heavily armed, whether their weapons are loaded or not, nobody seems to know.
Group who said they were members of the Black Panther Party retreated to a service station several blocks from the Capitol.
I remember this one cop came by on a motorcycle and he seen all these guns and he got on the thing, and that's when they started to swoop down on us from everywhere.
You have no right to take my gun away from me.
You don't know the Constitution, right?
Sure we do. We're well aware of the Constitution.
I would like to have a gun, but...
Why do you believe the legislature is racist?
Don't you know? You're a part of it, and you're obviously, it's a white system.
The news got to everyone in the black community who had a television, everyone who had a radio. It was in every newspaper across the nation. It put us on center stage.
I don't think that loaded guns is the way to solve a problem that should be solved between people of goodwill. And anyone who would approve of this kind of demonstration must be out of their mind.
When I heard about Sacramento, I was like, damn, these brothers are bad. They're here up in Sacramento in the Capitol, packing.
The boldness. The courageousness about it, the arrogance of it, that put a whole new face on things. I said, man, I want to be a part of this, whatever that is.
Good evening, Brother Stanley Nelson.
Good evening.
Sisters and brothers all, good evening to each of you. How do we begin? When we have just seen a clip from a remarkable film. A film about a group of young folk, 16, 17, 18, 19, 21 years of age, who dared to stand up in defense of black people. But we did see only a clip. And I would ask you, Brother Stanley, to say when everyone here could see the film in its entirety.
Yeah, thanks. The film actually will be played this Saturday night as part of the African Diaspora Film Festival at MIST on 125th Street. So I encourage everybody who can to go. And you can just look that up, you can Google African Diaspora Film Festival at 8:30 on Saturday night, and I'll be there for Q&A afterwards. And then the film will also, it'll be on PBS all over the country on February 16th. It'll be on PBS, but it's really fun to see the film on a big screen with an audience, especially on 125th Street, so. No, it's 116th, I'm sorry. It's 116th Street, I'm sorry. It's 116th Street. So, but that should be a lot of fun on a Saturday night. So I encourage you, if you can, to go see it.
You know, to show a clip is, of course, to deny us the totality of that film. And since I have watched it in its entirety with my husband, what we do not see in that clip is the fact that the majority of the rank and file members of the Black Panther Party were women. So, what would you expect of the former president of Spelman College and Bennett College? Of course, I would ask if you would just speak to that for a few moments.
Yeah, that was actually one of the things that really surprised me, in making the film. You know, we knew that women were a large part of the party and that was something that we really wanted to show in the film. And, we really looked for women to speak in the film and former Panthers to speak, besides, Kathleen Cleaver, who's in the film, Elaine Brown, who's in the film, but also women who were part of what was called the rank and file. Those, what I call the worker bees, those people who weren't famous, weren't trying to be famous, who were just part of this movement. But, as we went on, we found that by the early 70s, women actually made up the majority of the party. And that was just, incredible for us. And we really, in the film, we wanted to kind of illustrate what women did in the party and their role, which, included, as somebody said, everything from carrying a gun to cooking breakfast to answering the phones to doing what the men did. And so it was something that we really wanted to really highlight in the film.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think we all know, we women folk and men folk who are our allies, that our presence does not necessarily mean that we're receiving the respect, the leadership roles. And I'm going to have to quote Elaine Brown, and we'll get to Elaine later, when she says, "We didn't find these brothers in revolutionary heaven. They had obviously come out of a society in which, yes, a black and African-American society, which had yet to really struggle and win on questions of gender equality." But let me move a little bit away from that, and we can come back to anything else that you really want to talk about. You cannot look at that film, Brother Stanley, and not think about today. You can't. And you knew that. 7 years ago when you started to make that film, you knew that. But in these 7 years, how have you looked at race and other diversities differently than 7 years ago?
Well, you know, I started the film 7 years ago, and I thought, you know, that the Panther story was relevant then, you know, that it was a story we didn't know and that it was relevant to our world 7 years ago. Our world has changed, I think, drastically in that 7 years, and as time went on, it just became more and more and more relevant to where we are today. So I think that's the experience that I traveled through in making the film. You know, what was really funny was one of the reviewers of the film said, you know, well, you know, Stanley doesn't ever tie it to what's happening today, you know, and I was like, well, you know, I mean, we could have like ended with some marchers, you know, Black Lives Matter, but I think, you know, that's kind of hitting you over the head if you don't understand the relevance of the film today. I mean, you understand it from the little clip we showed, which is like 10 minutes from the very beginning of the film. So I think that, you know, what's much more important to me than to hit an audience over the head with the relevance today is to let you make those connections. I think that makes it much, much more poignant, much more real for an audience. And instead of me trying to tell you that there's a relevance, is you yourself are like, oh, you know, there is a relevance here. So that's what we tried to do in the film. I mean, it's obvious, you know, what happens, you know, 2 minutes from where we left off is we start talking about the 10-point program. And what's so amazing is, you know, the 10-point program, none of the things have been realized. And they're so essential to, you know, what we're fighting for still today. And we kind of end the film also with a 10-point program. And I think that's as much as we could do to remind the audience that, you know, these things are still relevant and still what we're fighting for today.
Well, as somebody who on many a day participated in that free breakfast program, that's an era I was a part of. Someone who knew about the Black Panther Party's free health clinics. I'm really struck by the way in the film that you managed to show both the uncontested revolutionary spirit of the Black Panther Party and what you, I think, would say is the party's insistence on being of service to the community in a very fundamental way, to serve breakfast to children. So would you talk about how you see, I don't want to call it the two faces of the party, because my own sense is that they were very integrated, those two ways of acting.
Yeah, I mean, I think that it's really one face, you know, it's the face of change, and I think it was really important to the party. I think that one of the things that drove us in the film was that the party, how people have come to think about the Black Panther Party is very different from who the Black Panther Party was. But also I think was really important to us was it's very different from how the party was thought of even back then. Mm-hmm. You know, back then we kind of all knew that the party was serving breakfast to children. We all knew that there were these other parts of the party. One of the things that we do in the film is, you know, you kind of see it. You see many times, there's a great shot of Eldridge Cleaver speaking, and it's from the back, and he's speaking in front of this huge audience, and the audience is 95% white. I mean, that's the, you know, you can't help but see that, and, you know, we don't try to flash a sign, you know, white, you know, we don't need to do that, but I think you see that this was who, you know, who were listening to the message of the Black Panther Party besides black people. There's a great picture in the film that I just love. It's just a still, and we don't make any comment about it at all. But it's at a march. It's a white man and a white woman on a stage, and they have this big sign that says "Women's Liberation," and under it, it says, you know, "Free all the Panthers." You know, and it's that kind of thing that we just wanted to give you an idea, you know, of who the Panthers were thought of, how the Panthers were thought of back then, because I think it was very different than they've come to be thought of. And, you know, one of the things that J. Edgar Hoover, who, you know, as the film goes on, kind of gets a starring role, that J. Edgar Hoover says is, you know, that he wants to isolate the Black Panther Party. That's one of the, you know, kind of the three things that he says he wants the FBI to do, is to isolate the Black Panther Party and make it so all youth disrespect the party.
Because you've raised the name J. Edgar Hoover, Stanley, do you think that young folk today have any sense of what surveillance was really like during our era? Is there any sense now that is not over?
You know, I think that there is a sense, at least among some of the people who are working with Black Lives Matter and other groups. One of the first things that we did when we finished the film is we held a free screening of the film in Ferguson, and we brought a former member of the party and some of the activists in Ferguson to talk, and we're talking. And one of the things that they said is, one of the women said, is that when she goes home at night, you know, there's drones like hovering above her house. Now, who knows what that is? But that's part of what surveillance is about. And, you know, that whole thing is it's about that you never know. You know, you never really know, you know, what's going on, if you're being followed, if somebody's listening to your phone. And finally, as you see in this film, you don't really know who your friends are. And that's one of the saddest thing about what happened to the Black Panthers. As the film goes on, you see, you know, the FBI was putting huge amounts of you know, manpower, and I'm not going to say man and woman power, because the FBI was all male at that point. It was manpower and money, you know, into destroying the Panthers, and that was the main thing that they were trying to do. And the Panthers were teenagers, as you said before. You know, you're trying to destroy this group of teenagers, and also I think at that point nobody understood what the FBI was. You know, I mean, this was a time when there was a show on Sunday night with Efren Zimbalist Jr., the FBI. We all used to watch that, brought to you by Ford Motor Cars, I think it was, you know, because all the cars were Fords, and, you know, they would drive, like, really close up, and you'd see the Ford logo whenever they stopped. But, you know, so that's who we thought the FBI was, you know. These were big heroes, and nobody understood what that they would not only wiretap, but they would also... you know, have agents, you know, who would infiltrate your organization, but also agents who were psychopaths. I mean, literally psychopaths who would, you know, I mean, these were informers who would, you know, spur you on to do whatever they could get you to do, and they would help you do it. You know, I mean, they did some very, very evil and sneaky stuff that nobody, you know, I mean, we kind of know now, you know, that they tried to make Castro cigar explode and all that kind of crazy stuff, but you know, nobody thought that's who the FBI was, and that's what this kind of espionage was at that point. So I think that there is a little bit of more of a recognition today, but you know, who knows what they've gotten? Who knows how far they'll go? You know, they're using, you know, facial recognition software to figure out, you know, who's in marches and who does what and all those kind of things. So they have all that stuff and they're using it.
I can't remember if this is in the film or I read this. But you have said that the Black Panther Party really came out of a deep love of Black people and a commitment to empowering Black folk. That statement reminds me of something that James Baldwin once said. He said, you cannot teach children that you do not love. So Stanley Nelson, I've got to ask you, these days, who loves black people?
Hopefully we love ourselves. hopefully we love ourselves, and hopefully, you know, that is something that can sustain us through whatever happens. I mean, I think that, you know, where we might make a mistake is to feel that we're gonna get some love from somewhere else. And, you know, I mean, and that's one of the things that you know, I mean, people have said that nobody believes in America more than black people. And that's probably the truth, you know. But I think at this point, we're seeing that it's really important that we love ourselves and go from there.
You know, I'm also thinking of a slogan that was very popularized by the Panthers, and you know what it is. Black is beautiful and power to the people. You know, those are amazingly basic and powerful statements. Make the connection now, though, that I know you want to make through the film without hitting us over the head with it. And that is what relationships you see between current movements and the vanguard of the revolution, the Black Panther Party. Of course, many of us are thinking about Black Lives Matter. Many of the folk in that movement are young. They are pushing in the hardest possible way against police brutality. So what are the lessons that the Panthers could teach to a movement called Black Lives Matter?
Yeah, I think that there's so many lessons to be learned from this movement and this experience. You know, I think that, and those lessons are good and bad. You know, I think that, again, you know, everybody hasn't seen the film, so I don't want to go too far, but I think it's important, you know, that you understand that it's not only a positive message, but, you know, the Panthers also kind of fell apart, partially because of the way it was structured, partially because it was very top down. There was very much, you know, Huey and Eldridge and Bobby, and, you know, and those were the leaders, and I think that was to their detriment. My understanding is one of the things that Black Lives Matter is trying to do is have more of a kind of leaderless movement, and some of that may be as a result of what happened to the Panthers. I'm not sure, you know, if that, how that can work. I just don't know. I don't want to say, you know, yes or no. It's a different way of looking at things. It's a little scary because I think one of the things that happens is, you know, we are so accustomed to leaders that if we see somebody on the news three times, you know, where, okay, that's the leader. You know, that must be the leader. You know, I know, and, you know, and I know I'm the same way. You know, I saw somebody from Black Lives Matter on TV a couple of times, and I was like, said to somebody, oh, I just saw the leader of Black Lives Matter. And they're like, no, that's just, you know, so I'm not sure. So, but I think that the Panthers can be a real inspiration to people. You know, there's a picture in the little clip that you saw where, you know, they're standing out in outside in a yard, and it's Huey and Bobby and Big Man Howard who's talking, and he's, you know, talking about how they formed, and little Bobby Hutton is sitting there, and the Forte brothers are there, and it's six guys, and that at that point, that was the whole Black Panther Party. That was it. That was all there was, and I think it's that's really phenomenal that here we are 50 years later talking about this movement that kind of swept the country and caught on, you know, and made mistakes, sure, but, you know, they were organizing geniuses. You know, there was not anybody in the country at that point who didn't know about the Black Panther Party. So again, I think that can be an inspiration. We're not saying, you know, I hope through the film, you know, that they are a model. We're not saying pick up a gun, but we're saying that organize, and, you know, you do have power. And these were teenagers who, you know, had nothing and formed a movement. I think that's really important.
you are an artist. I mean, your medium is film, and I now work in that arena. I am deeply, deeply struck by the role of Emory Douglas, the Minister for Cultural Affairs, however the language was, the artist. Talk a little bit about his role in the party.
So Emory is in the film there. You see Emory there. But you know, as we go forward, we do talk about Emory's artwork. And one of the things that I really wanted to do from the first moment I knew that I was going to make this film was make sure we talked about Emory Douglas, because Emory Douglas, his art was something that I remembered. I was, you know, I was not a member of the party. I was kind of a little bit younger than that. But I remember the papers and his artwork, which was kind of this takeoff on kind of Cuban and Chinese revolutionary art that Emory did. Emory has become kind of a world famous artist now, but he did these incredible drawings that every week would be, you know, a big part of the paper. And he had these really beautiful drawings where he just, showed members of the black community. And sometimes they would be, you know, a black woman with a baby on her back and a rocket launcher in her hands, you know. But they were beautiful. And if you haven't seen them, there's actually a great book of his work. I think it might be out of print right now, but I think you can get it on eBay and stuff. But it's incredibly beautiful stuff. So that was Emory. We really wanted to talk about Emory because for so many of us, you know, that was a reason to kind of buy the paper. And it's kind of hard to understand now because, you know, papers are in a very different situation than they were. But the Black Panther paper was kind of the first point of contact for most people with the party, or so many people with the party, because in every city, in every black neighborhood, on the street corners, the Panther paper was being sold. You know, constantly. That was how the Panthers made money, and it was one of their duties as a Black Panther was to go sell the paper. So everybody had a paper, you know, or somebody you knew had a paper. Or you went, you know, in their house and they had a paper, and you saw, you know, Emory's artwork. But there was also another side of Emory's artwork. So he did these beautiful kind of color paintings that were just incredible. But he also had this other thing that we talk about in the film, where he did these drawings of the pig. And he kind of invented the pig, you know, the police as a pig or soldiers as pigs, but mainly the police as pigs standing up on two hooves, you know, with a bandolier and a rifle and flies flying around and kind of popularized the slogan "Off the Pig." And later on in the film we do kind of a whole little riff on "Off the Pig."
Mm-hmm. When Don introduced you at the beginning of our evening, he gave us a sense of just the extraordinary range of films that you have done. And while you may be most associated with documentaries that describe us as a people, our unbelievable triumphs against almost unspeakable difficulties, but you've also done films about Native American folk, a film about Puerto Ricanos. You've done a film about immigration and Latino folk. What is it that leads you to decide to do a film about who?
You know, I don't know. I mean, the only thing I can say, I tell you a story. You know, the first film I made was, first major film I made was $2 and a Dream about Madam C.J. Walker. And I made that film partially because I thought it was a great story. But my grandfather was her attorney and her business partner. And it was a story that had always been kind of in my family, you know. And I made this film a long time ago, 25 years, something like that, ago. And at that point, you know, black people knew the story a little bit, you know, but it wasn't the story, as it is now. So it was a story I thought that most people didn't know, and a story that I really wanted to tell. And again, it was like this family story. And it took me 7 years to make that film. And so, you know, it was a real struggle to get the film made. And so, you know, what that made me feel is that, you know, you don't know how long it's going to take to make a film. You know, it may take 7 years. And so it better be something that you're really, or I'm really interested in doing, and that means something to me. And that's just my own take on it, you know, for myself. You know, I mean, I can respect a filmmaker who wants to do a film about whatever, if that's what they want to do. But for me, you know, if it's going to take 7 years of my life, I want to try to do something that is meaningful, at least to me. And so that's kind of, you know, where I've gone with the films that I've made.
I'm sitting here thinking about one of the times that I had the real honor and the joy of being with you. Marcia was there, your wife. We were in the White House. And you received from President Barack Obama a National Medal of the Arts. I don't know, Brother Stanley, but you know, when you receive that award, which is the highest award in the arts in our country, and when you are defined as a genius, you are a recipient of a MacArthur Award. I really want to ask you, what do you do to remain as down, as approachable, really as pure D wonderful as you are?
Oh, geez. I'm a documentary filmmaker. You know what I'm saying? So it's very different when you're a documentary filmmaker. You know, it's not like, you know, I go to a restaurant and they're like, "Oh, here's Stanley Nelson. Let's give him the best table." You know, when I get on the subway, you know, they're like, "Oh, just go on. You don't have to pay. You know, don't bother with paying today." You know, you get on the subway, everybody's like, "Oh, here's a seat." No, you're Stanley. You know, so it's you know, my life, you know, day to day is very, very humble. It's not like I'm usually sitting up, you know, talking to an audience. You know, I also have a family, and that they keep me very humble. Thank you. I think that filmmaking is really, you know, a matter of getting in the trenches and making the film and films and trying to get better at what you do. You know, I mean, I just taught for a year at Morgan State in Baltimore, and you know, one of the things I kept telling the students, you know, is you've got to love this. You know, if you don't love it, then do something else, because the rewards are not that fantastic. You know, it's not as if, you know, the people are going to be throwing flower petals at your feet. You know, it's really you spend a lot of time, you know, worrying and fretting and trying to figure out what you're doing, and a lot of times alone in the edit room or with the editor trying to figure things out. So I've got a lot to be humble about, you know, so it's easy.
I made a reference to it earlier, and that, of course, is Elaine Brown's critique of the film. In my world of art, in your world as a documentary filmmaker, we expect criticism. But how do you handle it?
You usually try not to, whatever your first reaction is, you try not to do that. You know, you try to say,
wait a while.
You count to 10 and say, whatever, you know, my first instinct to get on the phone and call whoever it is, you know, call them back and tell them what you think is probably the wrong, you know, don't hit the send button. You know, that's probably the best thing you do. But I think that what, you know, so this film took about, you know, 7 years, took 4 years or so to raise money, 3 years in production. And, you know, by the time we got into, you know, we're a year into production, we realized that what we had to do with this film was kind of just go for it. You know, that there was no film that you could make about the Black Panthers that was gonna please everybody. I mean, if anybody can tell me what that film is, I'll be here afterwards and we can try to figure that out. But you know, that there's no film that's gonna please everybody. And so we just had to kind of bite the bullet and tell the story as we saw it and make the best film that we can. You know, and you're gonna get criticism, and in some ways, you know, criticism is great. It means somebody noticed you. You know, it really does. And so we were expecting. I mean, we got a lot less criticism than we thought we would get. A lot less. You know, we probably showed the film to, I don't know, 400 or more Panthers at this point. We probably have 3 that didn't like it. You know, which is you know, unbelievable. But you know, as an artist, look, you know, or as a human being, you know, most people want everybody to love everything you do. You know, they want, you know.
It's not gonna happen.
Right. Oh, Stanley, the way you walked across the room was so devastating, you know. But it's not what happens. You know, that's not life.
I want to read something written by one of my sheroes, Dr. Maya Angelou. And we remember a poem that she read at the inauguration of President Bill Clinton. And she entitled it, On the Pulse of Morning. Listen to this short passage from that poem. History, despite its wrenching pain, cannot be unlived. But if faced with courage, need not be lived again. My question to you is, have we as a nation faced with courage the racism, the brutality of the past? And if we haven't, is that why we are in some ways living it again?
Oh, I thought you were going to let me go off with a yes or no answer to that one. I think obviously we haven't lived up to where we should be and faced our past, you know, as a country. I think you know, one of the things though that I've seen in making a lot of films on the African American experience is, I think one of the things, and this is just my own feeling, is that one of the things, you know, African Americans want is just for it to be over. You know, like, okay, slavery's over. Now we're okay. Okay, that didn't work. You know, okay, now Jim Crow is over. Now, that didn't work. You know, now, oh, we got a black president. Okay, we're there. Nope, that didn't work. You know, and I think it's that, you know, we have to keep fighting and struggling, and it's like, you know, you're pushing that rock up the hill, that boulder up the hill. When you stop, you go back down, you know, and you just got to keep pushing. And when we don't push, that rock rolls back down. I mean, we've seen it, you know, in the news over the last couple of days. You know, this country's going crazy. Yeah.
I think we can't end this conversation without really moving to where you just were. There is something that's different now than 7 years ago when you began to make the Black Panther Party vanguard of the revolution. And in my view, it is that it is open season now on bigotry. And by open season, I mean say it, promote it, and make it on the news to be repeated incessantly. I really need you to, from your perspective, help us understand how the kind of bigotry, raw hatred, especially these days, against a folk who have a religion. How can that be now? And what do we do?
I think one of the things that's interesting, and I never thought about this before until just this moment, we finished the film on the Black Panthers in January, and basically the last year has been me running around with the film and showing the film all over the country. And I think, you know, until very recently, there was a very kind of subtle upbeatedness in this country in a way that these horrible things were happening, you know, with Black people being killed, you know, but there was finally seemed to be people were looking at it and talking about race and thinking about race in a very different way than they had. And I think it made the reception of this film totally different. I mean, you know, the reception of this film all over the country was just amazing. You know, we were at Film Forum. We were held over for 6 weeks or 8 weeks or something like that. You know, the whole thing was just amazing. And I think that there was that. And I think what's happened in the last really few weeks is a lot of that has been erased, you know, and now we're seeing things, another piece of this country that we hadn't seen. But I think that it's really important that we remember, you know, where we were a few months ago, when, you know, people seemed to be thinking about race, thinking about this country in a different way. And maybe part of this whole thing that's happening right now is also in some ways a reaction to that, but I think again, it's we can't get defeated by it and be silenced by it. And the other thing we were talking about a little bit, and what's really embarrassing is to be part of the media at this point, because I think that the media is just, you know, really has kind of just given up any kind of idea of what journalism, you know, really should be and really is about, and has really just given up the idea of doing what the media is supposed to do, and it's embarrassing. It's embarrassing.
You know, I think we should turn our chairs a little this way, and we should invite sisters and brothers to go to the microphones on either side. Let me use a little bit of the Spanish I command by saying, ustedes tienen la palabra. Your mics are there, you have the floor.
Don't be shy.
Hi, Stanley. Miles McAfee, MacArthur College. I wanted to thank you, brother. We showed the Panther film on Friday night. It was packed house, incredible. And just thank you for being such a warrior and presenting images that empower all of us, Black, white, brown. Thank you. I know as...
I also want to thank you for showing the film, so thank you so much.
I'd love to sit and hear you talk about what's going on in society all day, but I want to get to the question. I know that, like, with a filmmaker, there's the challenge of what to put in and what to not put in, because you can't put everything in your film. Was there something that you didn't put in that you really wish you could have, or something that a part of the story that you wanted to tell but you just didn't think it would fit in with the particular narrative that you had?
Yeah, it's a good question. So first I should say that one thing that I've been really good at is trying to, you know, to make the best film I possibly can, and then kind of just like biting a bullet and throwing it out there, like it's done, You know, and so I try, I don't sit there and fret about, you know, kind of what I should have done or what I didn't do, you know, and the little things that I do fret about, you know, if I told you what they were, you would say I was insane, you know. It's like, oh, I should have cut 4 frames off that shot, you know, it throws off the rhythm. But, you know, that said, I think that the piece that was in the film for a long time and that we actually asked people about and we shot and we cut was a piece about a shooting at a UCLA. It was a shooting between the Panthers and another Black national group called Us that was led by Ron Karenga. And it was just a really incredible story. So I'll tell you the story and that'll kind of explain why it got cut. So this was in 68, I believe. I mean, yeah, 68 or maybe the beginning of 69. UCLA had this program called the High Potential Program. And what they were going to do was take people who were kind of, in some ways, extraordinary in their community and get them matriculated into UCLA. Okay, remember, this is the 60s we're talking about. So they did this, and they enrolled the leaders of the Black Panther Party in L.A. Bunchy Carter was the head of the party, and John Huggins was another prominent member, and others. They also took another group, Us, a Black nationalist group, and enrolled members of Us in UCLA. Okay, so they're all like, these are now their students on the campus of UCLA. And what the FBI did was systematically went at setting these two groups against each other. So they would write letters, that were purportedly from Us to the Panthers, insulting the Panther leadership. They would write cartoons and put them under the door of Us that were supposedly drawn by the Panthers and insulting cartoons, and just fed this flame that ended up in a shooting where two Panthers, Bunchy Carter and John Huggins, were both killed. You know, they're killed in the student center on the campus of UCLA. It was a huge thing that happened. And we tried to tell that story, and we just couldn't tell it in a way that made sense. We couldn't find the witnesses to tell it. The film has no narration. I should say that there is no narration in the film. So we couldn't have a narrator kind of fill in the holes. It was a story we really wanted to tell, because what the FBI did after this was said, hey, this can work. You know, this can really work. We can really pit one group against the other, and they set out to really pit Panthers against Panthers. And that was one of the things that goes on to destroy the Panthers. But, you know, we're trying to make this work and make this work and make this work. And we all, you know, that whole long story I just told you, we had to tell you. So, you know, you're looking at it, you're like, well, why were Panthers on the campus of UCLA anyway? What were they doing there? Well, they were there because of the High Potential Program. So we then had to explain the High Potential Program. You know, all of those things. And they had a fight against who? Us. Oh, who's Us? So we had to explain who Us was. And so we had to do all that to get you to this shootout. And we struggled and struggled and struggled with it. And one day the editor said, you know, maybe we should just cut it. And I said, well, let's see. And now, you know, with the editing systems you use, you can basically press a button. As you press the button, we cut it. You know, we looked at the film. It just was so much better without it. And so that hit the cutting room floor. So that was the one thing that I wish we could have.
Let's go over to this side, please.
Hi. I have a question about will racism ever go away in our country, being that we have a capitalist system? We have a system that basically perpetuates and thrives based off of inequality and oppression. I mean, is it inevitable that racism will ever be able to go away in this current society we live in?
Let's have a vote. Okay. So here's a vote. Okay. So is it going to be which is going to go first, capitalism or racism? Who says capitalism? Raise your hand high for capitalism. Who says racism? I think neither wins. You know, I don't know.
Over this side, please.
A non-political question about just doing documentaries. Two things. One, why does it take 4 years to raise money to do something like that. And the second question is, in finding all the films that you had to find, or is there one that was just came out of the blue that you just, you wonder how you ever got it, that we would be charmed by that story?
Sure. So, I mean, I, as a documentary filmmaker who's been making films a long time, you know, 4 years to raise the money, that's like nothing. That's like a blink of the eye. So, I mean, I think you have to understand that, that, you know, documentary films basically live on, in a strange math. You know, this film is not going to make its money back. It just doesn't make the, you know, so documentary films don't make the money back. So basically, you know, you're asking people to give you the money to make this film, and it'll never make the money back. So very rarely, you know, do they kind of make, turn a profit. You know, maybe a couple of Michael Moore's films turned a profit. Maybe the Penguin one turned a profit. And, you know, 20 Feet from Stardom that had Mick Jagger and Bruce Springsteen. I asked them to be in this film, but they that's kind of the myth. That's why it takes so long. And about the one piece of footage. Well, you know, maybe 4 years ago, I was showing a film, Freedom Riders, at the Schomburg, and somebody asked me, "What are you working on now?" I said, "I'm working on this film on the Panthers." And this guy, afterwards, you know, I'm shaking hands. He said, this guy came up to me and said, "Hey, I have a tape in my closet, in the back of my closet, and it's labeled Black Panthers." He said, "I don't know what it is. It's on this old style called Port-a-Pack, you know, and I don't have a way to play it, but it's labeled Black Panthers. Do you want it? You want to see it?" And I was like, "Yeah, great. Yeah, bring it by the office." He brought it by. Then we had to find somebody who had a Port-a-Pack so we could kind of see it. And it's this incredible scene where, later on in the film, where Huey and Eldridge have this kind of argument on TV. And nobody can find the TV show that it's on. They actually, it causes the huge thing that they call the split in the party. Half people go with Eldridge, half people go with Huey. They have this, you know, argument on TV. And nobody can find the TV show. Eldridge is in Algeria. And for some reason, the people in Algeria filmed Eldridge with his side of the phone conversation. And so that's the only footage that we could find. And that's the footage that we used to talk about the split in the film. Again, it's just totally out of the blue. But it's things like that that happen when you're making a film that, you know, you feel like, okay, this is just magic. You know, I'm like, somehow I'm on the right path. I'm doing the right thing. This, everything's going to work, you know, when things just kind of fall into place.
Thank you.
Please.
Before I ask my question, I would like to share just a little history about the Black Panthers. About 40 years ago, when I was a student, I was also working at How You Act Community Corporation in Harlem on 125th Street. And on 7th Avenue, there was also an office for the Black Panthers. I don't know if you remember that. There was a little restaurant there. It was some sort of a, what do you call that again? Soul food restaurant. And I used to go there.
Say that again, it was so beautiful.
Excuse me?
Soul food.
Soul food. Right, okay, it was a soul food place. And I used to go there. I am from Haiti, a native of Haiti. But I used to go there for their meatloaf, collard green, and sweet potato. Oh boy. Fantastic. But these young men used to go there. It was their home also to eat. And I wasn't afraid of them coming with their gun and everything. I wasn't, but they were so full of life. Once they step in, you knew there was life there. They were really fantastic. My second question, my question now is, how do you, the two of you, feel about losing our historical part, which is Harlem? How do you feel about it?
How do we feel about it? I live in Harlem. I'm not sure if we've lost Harlem yet. You know, I think that you know, there's still a lot of Black folks in Harlem. Harlem's big. Harlem's huge. You know, so who knows? We'll see what happens. I think that you know, those things happen.
We're losing it slowly and slowly.
Yeah.
And it is sad. It is very sad.
Thank you for the story, and thank you for the question. Sisters and brothers, I'm taking a feel of where you are. In some ways, perhaps we should begin to think about closure, but let's at least have two more questions. How does that sound? All right.
Sounds
as briefly as you can, please.
Sounds good to me. Thank you both. Dr. Cole and Mr. Nelson for presenting us with such a wonderful conversation. My question, I have a number of conservative friends who perhaps are no different than many who have a limited scope or who perhaps hear just the dominant narrative, which, if I can give an example, from my first introduction to the Black Panther Party was in high school, and it was portrayed as a radical group before I found that they were called the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense with these wonderful programs that you discussed. And, you know, the thing with the guns is frightening. And, you know, there's always conversation about gun control. And then an article came out in the news that said, you know, Ronald Reagan actually promoted gun control because these guys had guns. Like, Republican president, you know, governor at the time, gun control when these guys walked into the State House. And then, you know, some of my friends will say, wait, what's the big deal? Like, there was a march. There was a big march in the 60s, and you won, all right? You won. And the full name of the march was the March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom, all of which were eradicated probably just years later when everything outsourced overseas. To make a long story short.
And to get to the question.
Your work presents images that correct some of that myth information. And so as you are in a world that competes with this news media, which you said lacks integrity at times. Have you always been aware, or how are you aware of the power of your art form? That's what I want to know. Thank you.
How am I aware? You know, I think that the one of the things that drives me is that I grew up in a time. You know, I grew up in the 50s and the 60s. I grew up in a time when, you know, African Americans were not on TV at all, ever, for any reason, no matter what, unless they played an instrument or sang. That was it. I mean, for people who are younger than I am, you know, it might sound weird, but for people who are my age or older, and there are some in here, believe it or not, they can attest to the fact that you did never, there were no Black people, there were no Asian people, there were no Latino people, there were no gay people, they were not on TV or in the movies ever, you know. And so, you know, I started making films in the early 70s, that's when I got interested in filmmaking, when all of a sudden, you know, through blaxploitation films, other films, you know, we started to see Black people in front of the camera. And, you know, a group of us, you know, all over the country, men and women, said, well, wait a minute, you know, we could be behind the camera also. But we wanted to tell different stories. We wanted to tell, you know, different stories. And so that's one of the things that drives me, you know, in my filmmaking. I'm trying, you know, again, I grew up when there was nothing. And so it's that's the power of media. You know, I saw it. You know, I saw the power of media to erase us totally. And so now, you know, I think one of the things we're trying to do is put us back, you know, and keep us there and give us a history. I think that's important.
My sister, I think you're going to have the last question.
Well, I actually have a question for each of you. And Stan, I worked with Stanley actually for a while. And I want to say, first of all, I know I'm biased, but you got snubbed by the Academy. You deserve to be on that list. You deserve to be nominated for an Oscar for what you did for Black Panther. And my question is, in the documentary, and I've seen it a zillion times, but what bothers me and what I had a question about is the two officers. In the documentary, he has two officers who actually speak out against the corruption of other police officers, which we never see nowadays. And I wanted to know, was that your original footage? Did you actually speak to them? And do you know whatever happened to them? What was the reaction of these police officers in Chicago? They spoke about the Fred Hampton's assassination. They actually told the truth on what happened. And every day we're bombarded with police brutality stories, and we don't hear about police officers speaking out against it, which is so troubling to me because there are Black police officers who are involved in that. So you think, oh, Black police officer, yes, justice, but no, it's not that at all. So I wanted to ask you about that, and I wanted to ask Dr. Cole. I spoke to you 2 years ago at Williams College, and I asked you a question about the Black feminist movement, and I talked about how young Black women are getting tired. And in that 2 years, we've seen the Black Lives Matter started by three Black women. So we're making moves to the forefront, but at the same time, nobody actually really knows that fact, and nobody's still talking about Rekia Boyd. Nobody is talking at all about Sandra Bland. Like, that story is faded, and that's the most troubling story, I think, in 2015. I wanted to ask you, what advice can you give to young Black feminists in order to make our voices more prominent and powerful within the Black Lives Matter movement so that our stories are also told? And my request is for Dr. Forbes. He wanted to speak. Please let Dr. James Forbes say one last word after I do. Thank you.
Ooh, a sister can get a lot into one question. But I do want to thank you for all of that. And I want to thank you particularly for what you said about men and women who can be righteous members of a police force. Of our four sons, one is a policeman. You've asked what I think we women folk can do to have our voices more clearly heard. And all I can say is we just got to keep saying it. You know, it's so easy for us to be wiped out. Few folk will acknowledge it was a Black woman who really named a movement. It is called Black Lives Matter. Whenever we are outraged by horrific violence against Black men, we need to remember that somewhere in a bedroom, in a house, somewhere there was violence against a Black woman. And so we women of color, acknowledging not one but at least two of our identities. And for our sisters who are lesbian, who are bisexual, for our sisters who are poor, we've got to simply speak louder, clearer, and act. You know, I'll try to wrap this up. She shouldn't have asked me this question, Stanley. By actually giving counsel, not from a woman, but from a righteous man. It was Dr. Martin Luther King once asked, then, how in the world do we get this change that we so desperately need and deserve? And he said, and I respond, that we Black women must do this too. We've got to educate, said Dr. King. We've got to legislate, and where necessary, we've got to agitate. This is nothing new. This is what a film was about. A Black Panther Party that believed in education, that used the laws, and decided when it was time to agitate. Stanley, you have part of that question to respond to, if you can remember.
I can't remember what it was. No, I'm just, so the question was about the police officers in Chicago. They were members of the Chicago Police Department. They were part of, I forgot the name of the Black officers organization that they were part of. You know, they were righteous police officers. I think that one of the things that, you know, that was great that you said, Johnnetta, is there are police that join the police force for the right reasons. There's a guy in the film who was a Black Panther who afterwards became a detective in Chicago and the Chicago police force for over 20 years. He joined the police force to be out of his love for the people and wanting to do something to help the people. So I think that the two officers were part of the Chicago police force. I do believe that they, you know, stayed in the police force and retired from the Chicago police force. But we combine interviews with them from back then, from the night Fred Hampton was killed, to today when we interviewed them again, you know, in Chicago a couple years ago.
Now, if we have not woe you out, I don't know why not. You've been, though.
I want Dr. Forbes to speak.
I hear a call for a kind of benediction.
Perhaps it will be a benediction. There is a crisis now that, with respect to ISIS, it is that the propaganda wins the minds of young people from all around the world to join in that direction. So it's very clear that although we must protect ourselves, that this is an ideological battle, and therefore we will have to have some counter propaganda regarding the Western way of life of equality and democracy and justice and compassion and mercy. So what I want to do is to say a Mark MacArthur fellow is going to be asked to help our nation prepare the kind of media appeal that will make sure that the young people in our nation will always say, if I got a choice between that, I'm going to choose this as reflected in this documentary or in this photographic or film presentation. My question, what out of the richness of our culture are you going to use when you prepare the counter propaganda lifting up our way of life?
James Forbes.
I hope that the films that I've made, all the films that I may have made so far, talk about that kind of positiveness of spirit and of movements. That's what I'm really interested in. You know, if there's one thing that unifies the work that I've done, and it may be an accident, it's not something that I think about, you know, but it's about people, it's about movements, it's about you know, a positive movement, a positive message. I should say that we're working on a film now on historically Black colleges and universities and kind of the history of historic Black colleges and universities and their role in shaping the African American community and also in shaping America. So that's something that, that we're working on now. So I hope that, that my work, you know, that that's what my work reflects. I hope so.
All right. Well, I was thinking of a way that we might bring, no, there is no closure, that we might pause. Remembering now that our documentary filmmaker has gone back 50 years to the Black Panther Party to help us perhaps better understand where we are now and to do something about it, I'm going to leave you with two expressions. One is very associated with peoples in Ghana who use symbols. They're called adinkras. And there's always a message to a symbol. And I know that many sisters and brothers here know of that symbol, which is called Sankofa. Sankofa is the bird with a very long neck, and it looks back over its body. And the message of Sankofa is looking back in order to go forward. Where I grew up in Jacksonville, Florida, the old folk used to say, girl, you can't know where you're going if you don't know where you've been. Your film, The Black Panther Party, Vanguard of the Revolution, tells us where we've been. May we be more informed to go forward. Thank you, Stanley Nelson. Thank you. Thank you.